Earlier, when somebody wasn't paying you money, to be the technical term being a default in debt, a default in an amount payable, the options for a creditor, whether you are a bank, an NBFC, or even a trade creditor, or somebody who in the language of IBC is operational creditor, if you've supplied goods or services. So if you were to go behind a company, you would typically file as an individual, or as a business, you would file your suits, money recovery suits, and so on and so forth. Subsequently, when the winding up law came under the Companies Act, people would file winding up against companies alone, private limited and public limited companies. These would be filed in the high courts, and companies would be afraid of getting into winding up, and typically would, or not typically, but there are larger chances of disputes getting settled prior to a company getting admitted into winding up. But that is only for companies. You still had only the conventional options of a suit if you were going, or somebody who owes you money was a partnership or a proprietorship. Similarly, with respect to banks, the options were primarily your debt recovery tribunals, SARFAESI actions, and so on and so forth. The challenges with most of these, common challenges, were one, of course, the biggest thing, and India is known for, Indian judiciary is known for the delays. There was a phenomenal amount of delays. Even a suit would take somewhere, let's say 8 years, 5 years to get a decree. And then for you to execute the decree and convert it into money, ultimately, see, you've gone behind somebody, somebody owes you money. To convert it into money, that would take another 3 to 5 years. So you had two rounds of litigations to reach a stage where the person would make the payment. And by then, probably the litigation would pass on to another generation. That was a challenge for businesses to try and recover monies. As far as the banks were concerned, DRTs were initially functional reasonably. When they started off, obviously they were doing a decent job. But with time, the backlog got too much. Infrastructure was the same. And then came the challenges of, limited judges and so on and so forth. And so the DRTs also became slow. The NPA started mounting. The kind of lending was a little indiscriminate. Financial discipline was a challenge. There were several reasons which led to NPAs mounting, but it went to about, if I'm not wrong, the numbers that were quoted were a few lakh crores, 7 or 8 lakh crores. And then the government decided that, you need to have a comprehensive law to take care of all of this together. And that's how IBC was introduced. One more very crucial law, which IBC took over, was the SICA, your SICK Industries Reconstruction Law, wherein if a company is financially stressed or is in trouble, they would go and register themselves in a body called the BIFR, Board of Financial Reconstruction, that was in Delhi. You go and self-certify yourself, register yourself. And as a result of which, there is a moratorium on all the legal proceedings of civil nature or recovery nature pending against you. So it was a good way out for companies. Again, the objective of that law was to help out financially stressed companies to come in a better position. But unfortunately, the way things were, it was a little misused, and companies would just take a registration and sit over it. So with all this going on, basically, the creditor-debtor imbalance being huge, IBC came into place in 2016, and practically in 2017, the NCLT, being the court where these cases were being heard, were set up. While I am on NCLT, I'll just touch that NCLT is not something like a brand new, because it is, the name is new, but it was a company law board. Some of the members might be knowing it, but the company law board, which was established in 1991, but of course it had very limited benches, the four regional benches in metro cities. They became the NCLTs and some more were formed. So IBC is the law. A lot of people in the business community, I'll try to address as and when we come across some common questions. In the business community, it's called the NCLT law. NCLT is the forum and IBC is the law. So that's the background.
So Anant, just to understand here, who is NCLT applicable to? You have different structures, you have companies, you have partnerships, you have individuals as well. So just to get a clarity as to which category of structures does this NCLT apply to, and if you can just throw some light on that as well.
Sure. So basically, NCLT is applicable to corporate structures, primarily companies. It could be private limited, public limited, listed, and even LLPs. The law, the IBC, if you ever see the law, the court per se even talks about individuals and partnership firms. But that part of the law has not been notified. And pre-COVID, we were expecting the law to be notified for individuals and partnership firms by the end of this year. But I think we'll be covering how this whole situation. Of course, I'm sure you'll be having a lot of discussions around the whole discussion thing of COVID. But now we don't see saving corporates is a bigger I would say priority than bringing in a law for insolvency of individuals and partnership firms. So they are at the moment not notified. And if the law is as and when notified, the forum will be DRTs. One important sector or of category of people for whom the law is already in place, which people are not aware so much of, is the personal guarantors of the corporate debtor. So a corporate debtor is a company. Let's say you own a company, you've taken a debt of, let's say, 100 crores. And typically in the Indian context, the promoter is the personal guarantor. Typically, we just sign personal guarantees when in expansion mode, business mode, while we're taking on loans. So the law has been put in place, notified rather, in our legal language, in December 2019. So what they did is, in December 16, they bring in IBC, they test, trial, experiment, keep seeing what can be improved, just like GST, do whatever it, bring it to a certain level of maturity. Supreme Court has played a major role in it because a lot of judgments have been passed, giving clarity to the law. And in December 2019, they implement or they notify even the law for personal guarantors. But before that could take on cases could start getting heard. Of course, we are in a pandemic situation here.
Correct. So just to understand, I mean, given the historic, I mean, there have been a couple of years since this law has been already in function. And there was a time limit given, you know, when it started off that it has to be completed within a certain time frame of about 180 days and stuff like that. So practically, what has been the experience since 2016, the law was introduced? What has been the experience and what has been the practical number of, you know, realistic time frame one should look at if someone has to go this route as well? I mean,
yeah. Right. So first thing first, this is probably the first law in India where everything was prescribed in terms of, you know, days and time limits were given to every, if I would say, every milestone of the law. So basically one of the milestones was, or one of the time frame given was 14 days to decide upon a case by the NCLT. Now, I remember this is exactly what happened in the court. In June 2017, and cases were being heard since the 14-day, you know, if I may say, the sword was there at the, you know, neck of the judges. As much as they are listening to our cases, they were also seeing the calendar, and they were posting cases the very next day, you know, back to back. So on the 4th or 5th hearing, or let's say if I start my case on 3rd of June, by 7th or June or 8th of June, a judgment has to come out. But that initially mounted a lot of pressure, and in India, in a country where, as it is, the law was new. Where we are used to 14 years, you bring in 14 days, 14 years, if I'm saying on the lighter side, but yeah, you're used to 5 to 7 or 8 years of a litigation. You certainly bring in something like that. That created a lot of, I would say, pressure and panic. Also, it backfired because a lot of times, being a new law, the companies who were facing, suddenly if I file a case of insolvency against company X, company doesn't even know, and even the professionals were not so aware of the law. So yes, that backfired. Supreme Court relaxed it. It's mandatory. It's more like a recommendatory or something of that nature.
So
we made it into now at least a case which is filed by somebody who's in simple words, trade creditor or a services supplier. It takes about, on a ground level, it takes about 6 to 8 months for it to reach a stage of a final a decision. Either your case will be dismissed or whatever, decided in favor, or company would be admitted and so on and so forth. So this is till admission. Now, when a company is admitted into insolvency, you have a very clear-cut time frame saying that within 180 days, the company has to come out of the resolution process or go into liquidation. So the resolution process basically means company is in a bad shape. You have to find a way to do the resolution. Either an investor comes, a third party comes in. If you are not barred, you yourself as a promoter can give in a proposal, whatever it is. Find a way to rehabilitate and restructure and basically come up with a resolution plan. Now, initially, that was 180 days. The law provided for a further extension of 90 days. 270 days was what was there till a few months back when it was actually amended to another 40 days, another 60 days were added and made to 330 days. So the law, for the more or less 3 years that it has functioned, 270 days was the time frame. But again, at ground level, while some cases got resolved and went into liquidation, since there's nothing much in the company, then the bankers or the creditors who are the stakeholders who have a say would typically put the company to liquidation. But a company where either due to a lot of litigation, the promoter is trying to somehow save the company, there are too many bidders interested, XYZ reasons, delays, processes, internal litigation for several reasons, there have been several companies, a few hundreds of companies, the data is available with the regulator, the IBBI, about 600 days, 500 to 600 days was the average resolution time for at least 40% of the companies which underwent the process. So yes, you can take 2 years again on the ground level. Finally, there was another recent amendment about 4 months back, which said that, okay, even if there are a lot of internal litigations, you will do it up to 330 days. And beyond the 330 days from the date of admission, you have 330 days to either come up with a resolution or push the company to liquidation. Beyond 330 days on a case-to-case basis, the NCLT can give further time. So today, technically, you can actually, if you can prove that you've reached a final stage where your bidders are in, you are negotiating with them, you have 3 or 4 prospective people interested, you can get some more time. You have to really convince the NCLT.
So I think coming to the, you know, since we are in the middle of the webinar, I think this is the question which everybody would have right now is because of the COVID situation right now, there were certain announcements being made by the government to increase the limit from, 1 lakh to 1 crore. And, and it's also uncertain whether, a lot of uncertainty around it as to what about the cases which were admitted before, this event happened, and how is it going to be evolving given that there could be possible more further extensions? Would there be a situation of even suspending the law for some time? Because I think some countries like Singapore and other countries have actually relaxed it. So from a threshold point of view, and also from the, effectiveness point of view, what do you have to share? I mean, I think this is something which everybody is concerned,
Yes. Okay. So we'll first take the threshold part, and then we'll take the second part of the question, which is the possible suspension of the law, or suspension at least of the trigger sections.
Yeah.
So see, this threshold limit which was set was of 1 lakh. There were definitely talks, and the committee reports were being there are committee reports in public domain which were contemplating a revision of this 1 lakh threshold, because there was a lot of misuse. What would happen is if somebody just owes you 5 lakhs, 8 lakhs, 10 lakhs, and you are a reasonably decent sized company, for some reason, if you're trying to depend on what he provided to me had some dispute or deficiency, either the goods or the services, but for some reason it gets admitted into insolvency, it's not that you are not solvent, but this 1 lakh amount was being misused a fair bit, if I may be very frank on that. Yes, it did help. It did help a lot of creditors who did not have any bargaining power earlier. They do at least their monies, get into settlements, get into agreements where some kind of MOUs and so on and so forth. At the same time, when you're looking from the perspective of an MSME or a company per se, which has a decent standing, see, today nobody has the kind of cash flows of, in the last few years, nobody has had that kind of money where suddenly, if imagine 1 lakh is a threshold, 25 people or 20 of your creditors or 10 of your creditors stand up filing cases of 20 to 30 lakh segment or 30 to 40 lakh segment each, it's difficult to settle 3-4 crores in one shot, taking money out of your running business. So definitely the threshold increment was up on the cards. What was being anticipated was something between 10 or 25 lakhs is what were the informal talks that we've at least heard from the, you may say informal indicators from the government and the ministries, like whoever relevant people in the system. The official committee report, the insolvency committee report, came up with a proposal that it should be 50 lakhs. But given that operational creditors who are of smaller nature will lose complete bargaining power, we are proposing it to be 5 lakhs, from 1 lakh to 5 lakhs. Now this 1 crore thing has come as an absolute shock, a surprise to everyone across the bar, industry, professionals, all of us. Now it's a very debatable subject whether 1 crore is fine or not. The exact words used by the finance minister was that this is to save or to support the MSMEs. So first question or first part, I will clarify, or if I may clarify this, because this has been coming to us as a very, very common question, that this threshold is only applicable to companies which are of MSME nature or who have an MSME certification, or to anybody. It is to anybody. The very same evening, very same night, there was an ordinance which said that 1 lakh is to be read as 1 crore. So there is nowhere where it says that only if you're filing against an MSME, your threshold has to be 1 crore. So even if you're a large corporate or a smaller company, you are not coming in this category, it affects you. The other part of it is, right now, the given situation, probably 1 crore could be something which could be seen as reasonable. The connected part which you said, there's a lot of unclarity, a lot of I would say ambiguity, or there's no clarity at all. What happens to the pending cases? Now, I have filed a case, my case is in the registry level, or I have issued a demand notice before IPC. There is something called a mandatory demand notice you have to send. I'm trying to avoid legal words and use business words. So there is a mandated notice that you need to send. What if I have sent the notice or filed the case, it's at the registry, or even if my case has reached the hearings, that is at the initial 2 or 3 hearings level, or just before the final hearing. We don't know what is going to be the cutoff that the government is going to keep for these cases and for the 1 crore threshold. If the intent is to minimize the number of companies from the date from 24th of March when this was announced to be admitted into insolvency, probably as long as a company is not admitted into insolvency and orders have not been released, those companies, all those cases will, in legal language, the word is abated, but basically it will apply to all those cases. So even if you've taken the legal course, maybe yes, you will get the benefit of the time you spent in court will be excluded and limitation law and this and that. But yeah, so that's going to be, but we are awaiting clarity. What is going to be the cutoff point? I think the second part of your question on the suspension. Okay, yes. Sorry, you were having something?
No. So the suspension part, I just wanted to check. Yeah.
So the suspension part is, again, the announcement was that depending on the situation, as on 30th of April, or as let's see how it goes, we might suspend the 3 trigger sections. So in IBC, there are 3 sections. If you are a financial creditor, which is a banker, lender, NBFC, there's a particular section, it's called 7. And if you are a trade creditor or someone who supplies services, goods or services, an employee also, there's a particular section called section 9. And section 10 is equivalent to your BIFR, where you yourself go and say self-insolvency. So the objective is to possibly suspend these 3 sections, which means there won't be new insolvencies. Companies won't be facing new insolvencies. Could probably be a breather for, she's indicated 6 months. So it would be a breather for companies to not face insolvencies. And in a way, limited discussion has happened on this, but there is a line of thought which says that yes, this is a need which is a need of the hour. Similar as you mentioned to Singapore. Singapore has also increased thresholds and also given a by and large, a time period of 6 months. But the other side of it is, what actions will bank takes? What do you do now as a creditor? If you are a debtor with a lot of exposure, yes, it would be in your benefit. But if you're a creditor who has to get receivables, where do you go today?
So just a follow-on question, Anant. Now, from I think from a member's angle, I think there is no business which has not been impacted. I think each and every business, whether it's a small or medium or large, this is such a situation. I think probably the only industry wouldn't have got impacted as the pharmaceutical industry, but otherwise literally each and every one, big or small, has been impacted. Yesterday we had a webinar in our chapter as well, where the main topic of discussion was cash preservation, right?
Right.
Every business today is taking steps where there is, we wouldn't have even imagined taking it in a normal situation,
Absolutely.
But you're forced to now preserve cash. So we are talking of, delaying statutory levies. How do, and also, you know, certain creditors of you know, businesses which normally we would have paid on time or with maybe reasonable delay. Today, we are evaluating options that how do I not pay for some reasonable, I mean, we don't know what the cash position is, so how do I delay it maybe beyond reasonable time, and what could be the possible implications a business could face genuinely also. I mean, and some people would obviously take advantage of it, but if suppose genuinely I'm in a crisis situation and I want to delay my payment, what is it that I should keep in mind that my creditor can come after me, so that I take calculated risks and not something which you know, I just blindly take some steps and later face the repercussions for it. I mean, just you know, as a checklist, if I just want to ask you that, you know, what are those laws which I could possibly be need to be careful about, and how can I buy time? In short,
a lot of our clients have already been asking us that. So now in this situation, what do I do? So your question comes in pretty much from a client perspective, in the sense what a lot of businesses, which and this is something which, as you rightly said, unforeseen. So here I'll take the liberty to be a bit candid. Now, if you owe money to somebody, first thing we've seen, as a matter of pure experience, we've seen Indian companies or a lot of businesses that happen at the MSME level, or for that matter in India, unless you are at the very, you know, corporate structure level. It's a lot of business and the lack of communications, more on face value, so on and so forth. So if you have a situation where somebody has supplied you some goods or services or something of that nature, and there are some quality issues, disputes, or some concerns with respect to that particular goods or services, please get your documentation in place. Raise those disputes then and there. Don't wait for somebody to file some proceeding, be it an NCLT, IBC, or some case, or some suit, or something, and then try to prove in the court of law. The first thing is, make sure you do that. Secondly, the one law that you'll have to be a little cautious about is your check bounces. If you've given post-dated checks to your creditors, there's not much that you can do, because unless they suspend that law also, which doesn't look like at the time being, check bounce is going to be one proceeding which the creditors are going to go against the debtors, against people who owe them money. But again, thankfully, that's a proceeding which will take some time. And let's be realistic, right now the courts are also pretty much on a, if I may say, very, very, very minimal functional mode. They're just trying to migrate. I'm not even saying migrating. We are trying to migrate towards online hearings and virtual hearings and so on and so forth. So it will take about a couple of months to realistically get that kind of, you know, infrastructure into judicial system as well. Unless things get back to normal by June, it's a different issue. So there is going to be some time lag even in the judiciary side to move on to a hearing where there are effective hearings. So yes, 138 would be something, but that would take some time. Even if it starts, I think there's some buying time you can do. The third thing that assuming IBC is suspended, typically your creditor will file a money recovery suit against you.
A civil suit, which
you can take some time again, and they may file a summary suit if you've given them confirmation of balances, or, you know, if it's a crystallized liability. A summary suit means basically a suit where you're trying to avoid the legal thing of a trial and so on and so forth. So those you'll have to be a little cautious, but then as I said, 138 and civil suits, you can get some breathing time. 6 months to 12 months is a pretty doable thing. DRT, yes, you have to be a little cautious. Though DRT is slow, but if the bank is progressive or the bank is very proactive and is somehow trying to bring your assets on auction and so on and so forth, that's something which you will have to be cautious about.
Who can go to a DRT, for instance? Given that if you can't go to NCLT and you go to DRT,
DRT is for the financial sector. The bankers can go, and NBFCs who have a net worth above a certain amount. It used to be 500 crores. I think they've relaxed it a little bit, if I'm not wrong, 100 crores. Okay. So yeah, so it's not for the normal businessman. You can't go to the DRT. Okay. So at least thankfully, if it's a pure trade credit, DRT is not an option, right? The better way right now is, that's to safeguard your company. Any more questions? And I thought this would be a good place where I could also say, if you are in the reverse position, how do you get your money out?
Yes.
So see, if you know very well that the guy who I'm taking a step back. In some cases where you have some contractual obligation, you need to pay the guy some money if it's a trade contract and so on and so forth. See if you can use something called the force majeure clause, which is pretty much being spoken about all over the place. There are some basic information is available in public domain. It basically means that it is beyond an act of mine, or whatever, an act of God, as they call it, beyond my control if something has happened. I am not liable towards my contractual obligation. So if you have large contracts with probably the government, or you're a supplier, or you're in the manufacturing sector, sometimes your contracts will be voluminous, which as a business you would never see. But now is the time where probably you will see, and you will invoke that force majeure saying that whatever my obligations are suspended for 60 days, 90 days. So if you have payment obligation, repayment or payment obligations, use that if it's making sense for you. So
since we are on this topic, just one more law, which is under the company law, the MSME Act, right?
Right.
While it's applicable on, you know, debtor and creditor side, is that something which the MSME sector can use as an option to recover, because you have a 45-day window which is defined as per Act, and what we understand it, we just want to understand, is that something which is effective, and how effective it is, to get your perspective on it, and is that an route which someone can use depending on which side we are in, whether we are on a creditor side or on a debtor side. If you can throw some light on the MSME Act as well, which has been quite prominently used now the past few years. Yeah.
Yes. So there were some amendments, and they brought in the Samadhan thing, and they made it a lot more online in 2017. So MSME Act, yes, there are some time periods within which you can, it's made a lot more simpler. Within 90 days, you're supposed to get an award. So if you're a creditor, if you're an MSME, first of all, if you're a registered MSME and there are some eligibility criteria, won't go into technicality. There's a good FAQ on the MSME thing available on the very website itself. But then if you're a creditor, you can certainly exercise the MSME route and go behind the corporate debtor or go behind your debtor, even if it's a foreign company to that extent. Eventually, what happens is the two challenges. You will get something called an award, which is as good as an arbitration award, and you will have to go get it executed. Same problem. For having it executed, you go for a round two of litigation, and people have used an MSME council award and filed cases in the NCLT also, because that was like a confirmed liability. A court of law has confirmed that, yes, this is the amount due. So the challenge is, as a creditor, how will you really get it implemented? Having said that, pre-COVID, the numbers have been reasonably encouraging. Settlements worth about 600 crores plus have happened between 2017 and now. And overall, the settlements that have happened are run into, at least, if I'm not wrong, 1,000 odd crores. Against the claims that have been filed, which may be 5,000 or 7,000 crores, across, let's say, if I'm not wrong, we were talking about 30 odd thousand cases or 25,000 cases. So which means the law is working. It's not like a dead and gone. Now, if you're a debtor in the same situation, I think right now it's a good time for debtors. In the previous thing we were talking about, if you are a creditor and you know that the guy owes you money and he's not in a position to give you money, of course, I'll be happy to take it in the form of questions, because there might be the business fraternity may feel that the challenges are more. Maybe it's not the right time right now for you to go behind your creditor legally, your debtor legally, because you know very well even he doesn't have the money. It's a supply chain which has got stuck. So the better way is rework your documentation, restructure, do whatever needs to be done. Let's say your claim is, we see a lot of things in India, generally situations where your business that you did was 2.5 years back. You're just nearing that limitation thing where you will lose out the right to go to court itself. Maybe sign an agreement as on date, crystallize the liability. Give him a schedule. He's on whatever legal action you take, any which ways, he can't pay you for 3 to 6 months. You yourself get into that kind of an arrangement and tell him that, okay, the defaults or the, let's say the payment should start from September or October 2020. Take post-dated checks. So rather than going around in a legal, getting in that legal chakravyuh, if I may say, or in that legal whole hassle of things in today's time, or let's say starting from May to September, rather wait till then. And you have a stronger situation to go, because it's a crystallized liability. You have probably if you can obtain post-dated checks, purely I'm saying this from a business creditor perspective. And you also make your case live as on today. So your limitation is 3 years from today.
So I mean, given that, the options are literally going to be negligible, I think, for this period, where the limit has been increased and especially only cases where 1 crore and above would be met. Is there a possibility that this threshold can be further increased as well? That's another question which a lot of members would have, is that it removes, I'm just asking one of the questions which, one of our members, Kirti Prasad, has asked, is that, is it really required, given that how many cases would we anyways be there if, given that the limit is increased to 1 crore? He's asking from a volume perspective, but I think today it's beyond volume also. It's also given the practical business scenario, you would have at least 10 times or 20 times more cases which are possibly going to come up for NCLT than it would come in the normal scenario. So do you see that possibility of threshold being increased as well to further than 1 crore, or do you see this, are there any talks or any deliberations happening?
At this point, there are no, at least nothing has come up. Even like, as they say, the government keeps coming up with advisory papers or some indicative something on their portals or seeking comments from the people. As of now, no. As far as 1 crore, increasing beyond 1 crore is concerned, any such discussions. Your second part of your questions, can it be done? Yes, by way of amendment of the law, it can be done. And this government, the way it has been amending IBC is primarily through ordinances. It may come up with an ordinance overnight and make it from 1 crore to, let's say, 2 or 5 crores.
But as of now, Anant, I think the law, which the current law states that...
So 1 crore is the upper limit.
1 crore is the upper limit, and the government cannot basically has to bring in an ordinance to actually amend the law and then increase the limit. But otherwise, the current limit is around 1 crore, right?
Current limit is 1 crore. So you can do it by way of an ordinance. Whether the government will do it or not is something to be seen. Now, your second part of your question is very relevant with this thing changing from 1 lakh to 1 crore. The huge clogging of NCLTs will come down. If let's say there are 30,000 cases today pending, just giving a random example, for sure, let's say 26,000 will automatically go out of the system if this 1 crore limit is, it's already in place. And let's say they say as long as companies are not admitted, insolvency is not started, all those cases go, please find some other remedy. Now, one challenge is, where do these guys go? Maybe we'll address that at some point a little later. But yes, the load will come down of NCLTs. But then suspension of the law, possibility of suspension in that context, is really a wait and watch situation at this point in time. And it's a very tricky situation right now. If the IBC is, at least the trigger sections are not suspended, we are going to see, as you rightly said, 4 times the number of filings, even if it's above 1 crore, than what we have seen in the last couple of years, because everyone will think that this is the fastest route to get somebody to come on the table. But you know very well that the moment you put somebody in insolvency, the thumb rule or the golden rule of IBC is, if you are an operational creditor, till you put him into insolvency in the process, you have some bargaining power. You can talk. The day you put him into insolvency, you lose your bargaining power. The banks pretty much take over the system. The banks, lenders, NBFCs, they take over. So there's going to be a left, right and center filing of cases if they don't suspend the law. But of course, this is a very, each one will have a perspective of their own.
Yeah, but given that, there may be a situation where, there may be, as a business, I've never had a, let's say the business has never had a black mark in the history of their,
operations,
business span which they've existed. And while the criteria is pretty much defined 1 crore, that's fine. But practically, if you really see, there may be a lot of businesses which will fit in into above 1 crore limit. How do you really practically see NCLT treating a genuine case? I mean, is there any going to be any form of leniency shown beyond the 1 crore limit? Because today I may fall under that 1 crore trap, and how do I ensure that, you know, I don't get trapped, and how do I protect myself? Is NCLT going to be lenient towards just beyond this criteria, or is just going to be just followed as per the criteria? That's another concern which a lot of businesses would have, that they're forced into this NCLT matter, and how do they protect themselves? How do they ensure that they handle this this next 6 months, 12 months period without getting into further issues? Because once you get admitted into NCLT, obviously you fall into the trap, and then you have several processes to be followed and things like that. So what do you have to say on that? I mean,
well, going by the experience in the last three years so far, the NCLT doesn't have the discretion to show or go into any subjective issue, leniency on a case-to-case basis, see that your company has, for example, we have taken pleas in our cases where we are going for a big manufacturing company that I have 800 laborers, 700 workers, I have a turnover of 300 crores, I have good orders in hand, XYZ, everything, but I can't pay this person, let's say 5 crores that he's demanded.
Correct.
So the NCLT says, I mean, the NCLT's view, at least for the last 3 years, at least as on date, post-COVID, things might change, there might be amendments on things like that, I don't know, but we can't really look at that. But then there could be a possibility that they say it in a bit more lenient manner, but most likely, given that IBC and NCLT is a very, very clear-cut law with respect to certain processes, and the way they followed it is to the extent they go with the law. There is very limited, the judges at times say that, our hands are tied. It's limited. The law says it's that way. Because if I had that discretion to decide between whether it's your solvent and you have people around you and this and that, then it becomes pretty much a civil code, a normal
code. So there wouldn't be a difference between a civil code and an insolvency matter.
Here is as simple as this. You may be whatever you are, but if you can't pay me my 5 crores that I'm demanding, and which is if it's crystallized, then you might have to.
So your answer is pretty clear that, there is a pretty clear framework which is put in place in NCLT. And if you fit into that framework, you pretty much are into the trap. So there's no way of looking at it from a leniency point of view that it wouldn't get admitted or you'll be exempted in any other form. So pretty much you have to be prepared. If you are above that limit, it's best that you start having some interactions with your creditors well in advance before things go
Yes. You should do that. See, at best, let's say what maybe as your professional or whoever your lawyer, whoever it is, can get you basically a couple of months of adjournments or two or three hearings. So it's a question of buying some time. Earlier, if I could buy 6 months, maybe now I can, quoting that because of COVID XYZ, I'll buy maybe 8 months or 9 months. But it's a question of just that additional time that you buy. The final decision will not change.
And so there was another question which is here by Umang Patodia. What is the PG law notified in December 2019? I don't know what this means, but
a personal guarantor. This is with respect to personal PG. Guarantor. Yeah. I had covered this in the beginning, maybe probably I don't know if it was there. But personal guarantor is someone who has signed a personal guarantee for a corporate loan. So if you're a company, your company has taken a loan from a bank, and you as a promoter, or let's say there are three family members have signed personal guarantees. Those three personal guarantors will come in this purview of this December 2019 notification, whereby if your company is either admitted into insolvency or not, the lender can go against you as a personal guarantor and file a case under IBC against you. So, which exposes personal guarantors in a really big way. So,
But keeping the limit in mind, Anant, right? Again, that 1 crore limit which is there would again be relevant here, I'm assuming.
The thing is that personal guarantor law was, it was notified. We haven't seen cases on the ground. So, because in December it came in by, you know, probably a few cases were filed. We haven't seen on the ground, but yes, threshold likely to be the same. Can't be that you have a lesser threshold for that.
Yeah, because every bank would have taken this for sure, right? Because any lending which happens is backed by a personal...
backed by personal guarantee and something which I would specifically... assuming we pass through this entire COVID period and all of this and we come back to our normal business in 6 to 12 months. This is something which is not to be taken lightly, because in personal guarantee, whatever is there in your name, your assets, movable, immovable, everything comes in the scanner. That's something which, especially in the context of Indian businesses, because our promoters are the ones who sign personal guarantees.
Okay. So another question, I'm just taking the questions, Anant, because we have another maybe 10, 15 minutes. So some questions are there, which I will ask you. So there's a question from Bala. Basically, his question is, you know, if you were to recommend the government on what should be the, you know, the current IBC regulation, what would be your recommendation to the government on the IBC front? Because given, you know, what the businesses are facing, is there something which the lobby or you have to say? I mean, apart from just the threshold limit, how this should be conducted in the given extraordinary situation. I mean, obviously, this is like, you know, once in a lifetime kind of a situation. But
we are hoping for that.
But what do you think from a recommendation point of view, if you were to give it to the government, what would it be and how one should look at it in the given circumstance? Yeah.
See, if one were to look at it from a larger perspective, the idea is to save businesses. And from a recommendation, though it will be very personal, what I think of it. But then purely from saving businesses, I possibly will go a step forward and say not just the threshold limit increase. Possibly you may have to suspend the whole law itself for some time, even if it is 3 months or 6 months or whatever it is. Reason being, even the companies, please understand, even the companies which are undergoing the resolution process, in today's time, who will bid for your company? Who has money to buy your company?
Correct.
I mean, you're struggling to survive. In the month of May, we'll be talking about survival. We're struggling to survive. We're going to be struggling that we save, you know, just about our basics and stuff like that. So even the resolution processes will be hit. So probably the law itself can be suspended. It would be a view. But then the thing is, the debtor community will be happy, but the creditor community will be certainly very unhappy as to what do you do. So maybe, just maybe, if we could contemplate and take lessons from probably the UK has come up with a COVID Act with respect to some legal obligations. Singapore, the most relevant one, where in fact, I'll share something with you as well on that front. So if we can look at something for businesses, obligations of businesses can be given a moratorium, not just in terms of, whether it is payment or contractual obligations for about 3 to 6 months. Find a way, some kind of a recommendation where the legal processes should not be put in place for these recoveries. I think that's something which is, that's a practical situation, because even if you go legal, if you're a creditor and you go legal, do you think the guy who owes you money will today give you money? Even pre-COVID, there were people who were using some reason or the other, general market downtrend, so on and so forth. Now, this is a good enough reason for somebody for the next 3 to 4 months to not release your funds.
It's a chicken and egg situation. I mean, you always have more people, the genuine guys less, and people who misuse the law much larger. So while on a positive side, like you said, I think, when we were having a conversation, that this is also one of the best times for businesses to restructure themselves also. And maybe this opportunity may not come because of this suspension of law. You may, get back on track as well for businesses which were possibly already in that insolvency process, that if it gets suspended, there's an opportunity for businesses to actually revive back as well. I mean, I don't know if that's going to be a case, but let's see and wait and watch.
No, that's something which will. I second your thought. This is a good time, especially if it is getting suspended. If it is not, yes, the bankers will still try going behind you. But yes, if we are in a, if you foresee a situation that there's going to be a financial stress, or you're moving towards an NPA, or one of your entities is somewhere there, it's probably going to be a good time to talk to the banks, because even they know they are helpless. There's no point going behind you legally, at least to the extent of IBC. So possibly a debt restructuring could be a good time.
Yeah. So from a, I think another question from Umang.
I can see that question. I'll just quickly, I think, yes, I agree. Civil courts will go out substantially, and yes, our children or I totally agree. I'm not going to defend. I mean, what's the, I mean, truth be told, that's a fact. That's the reason I said, better thing is wait, don't file cases, because the challenge is, while we are on this, a very practical point. In IBC, you can't trigger an IBC case if you have a pending suit, proceeding, arbitration, right, or something.
Correct.
So you go to, let's say you go to go file a civil suit in a hurry-burry or whatever it is, or not, you are in need of money. Someone says grandchildren also. Maybe the same. Yeah. So if you are in need of money, you file a civil suit. At best, you can look for, even being extremely optimistic, you can only get some kind of an attachment or an interim order or something like that. That will be 3 to 6 months.
Correct.
Might as well wait for this 3 to 6 months. Do what we have discussed earlier, a documentation where you crystallize your liability, secure yourself a little better. Let this IBC come back into play.
Correct.
And probably go.
I don't even know whether we'll have.
Is beyond 1 crore. If you're
I don't even know whether we'll have money for the lawyer. So.
Fair enough.
Because given the nature and the length of the case, I think that's the last.
Civil suits for recoveries of money is not a good option. Doesn't make sense at this point in time. Not that IBC was a law for recovery. Time and again, the courts have said IBC is a law for resolution. But given our setup, you know, people only when you put, you know, something on their neck, and IBC was losing your company, the fear of losing your company, the promoter would come and settle it typically. So yes, it was working well, but with 1 crore threshold, there has to be a way out, because if you're going to tell the people between, let's say, even a realistic number of 25 lakhs to 1 crore, there's a huge category of trade creditors in that bracket. If you're asking them to go back to civil suits, I think is very unfair. At least bring back some winding up, a slow form of IBC, maybe something like what your winding up was, something where you still, you know, can go somewhere, maybe a midway between IBC and civil suits. And there is a possibility that they may once again reduce this threshold limit or change the threshold when the situation improves a bit, maybe 6 months, 12 months down the line, because as of now they haven't said anything of that nature. But this government, at least as far as IBC and Ministry of Corporate Affairs is concerned, they are very open to suggestions, lobby various trade federations and bodies such as yours. When you give a representation, it actually is considered. So yeah, they may, because this is already a huge concern amongst a lot of businesses, that this 1 crore is making us completely out of the IBC process.
Just one last question, Anand, before we conclude. I think, you know, the home buyer versus the builder, right? This has been, you know, this has been a debatable point for many. So we just want to understand, what is the situation, or what is the position of a home buyer in IBC? And, you know, there were certain, you know, developments and new regulations which the government had brought in. So can you just throw some light on that, so that as a builder, you know what your position is, and as a home buyer, also, you know what your position is.
Okay. So let me first tell what the development has been, and then maybe I'll give the two perspectives, because I'm sure there might be somebody who could be a potential home buyer as well as there could be builders.
Correct. Yeah. There are more builders in our group than...
Right. Okay. But my answer will still be the same, because they need to be aware, more importantly, as to what they may
do. Yeah.
So initially, when the law came in place, keeping it very simple, to keep it very short, IBC was introduced. There was no position of home buyers. There was a complete gray area. Then the JP Infra case and Chitra Sharma, a lot of legal developments. Supreme Court said, chalo, it was a very emotional issue. This was an aspect which was decided not just judicially, but also with an emotional angle. seeing the overall sentiment of the country. And I still don't understand what the logic is. But without getting into that, home buyers were categorized as financial creditors. The moment they were categorized as financial creditors with that 1 lakh threshold, they started filing cases left, right, center, especially in the Delhi NCR region where you have more of builders defaulting and, you know, delays of commitments of giving the apartments on time and so on and so forth. So there were indiscriminate filing of cases, which led to a lot of builders getting into insolvency. Then again, a lot of representation from the builder body, CREDAI, and several other representations. And we've been speaking to a lot of builders. We have builders who are clients and so on and so forth. So then after a lot of representation, the government considered this and brought in a threshold saying that either 10% of your allottees of a particular project should approach the NCLT or a minimum of 100 allottees. So one of the two, whichever is, if I'm not wrong, whichever is less. Yeah. So that benefit was given. So you could basically go and so you're collectively going as a group and approaching against a builder to file a case in the NCLT. That ordinance was converted into an amendment brought into the law, but that has been stayed by the Supreme Court in January. And it says that all cases relating to this issue will be put on hold. I mean, the exact wordings are something else, but yeah, the ultimate result is status quo. On status quo means basically just pause on all these cases against the builders. So as on date, if you're a home buyer, even if you've gone in this consortium center, first of all, if you've gone individually, that is out.
Anyway,
the law is that of the ordinance. But even if the ordinance is stayed, technically you can say, which means we go back to the regime where one individual person could go and file against a builder. But given that there is a status quo, likely, and we are also seeing, this is all what's happening on the legal side. On the ground, we are seeing NCLTs just deferring all the cases against the builders and not admitting cases. There have been one-off cases in Delhi where they've been admitted and they said, let a project alone be put into insolvency resolution process, which I don't know how that can happen. How can you just take one project of a builder and do a resolution process for it? But yeah, today, as of now, the builders are a bit more in a safer position. And also from the home buyer perspective, we've always told home buyers that, see, the builder who is supposed to give you the apartment, if you put him into insolvency itself, I think nobody knows their business more than the promoter of a company, and in this context, a builder. So you are then expecting the company to go through a resolution process, allow some new person to come in or a new investor, an outsider to come in and revive this company and give you your apartment. We haven't seen actually successful resolutions even in companies which had gone into insolvency prior to all this, construction companies which were, you know, into development of apartments and so on and so forth. So I don't think as a home buyer also you should use IBC as much. You have options like RERA, I know not very effective, but then IBC is your last option. I mean, it's this way or that way.
Okay. Any concluding remarks, Anant? I think we are off time. Anything else you want to add, or we can?
I think we are good. I'll only say that I think I've already said both as a debtor and a creditor. Simple as this: if you owe money to people, what you need to be careful of a certain laws that might affect you or impact you. But it's better that you start a dialogue and, you know, see that you don't get into legal hassles. I'm thinking your focus should be to get your business back on track rather than getting into legal issues and dealing with lawyers. Whereas you're a creditor, you know any which ways that things are going to be slow. So you might as well do your whatever restructuring of your documentation and ensuring that you make your claim alive today and secure yourself to the extent you can and avoid legal for some time.
Okay. Thank you, Anant. Thank you very much for your time. I think we had quite an interactive discussions on the possible areas which could impact businesses, and I also tried and covered as many as points which would be relevant to our members. Hope you all have found it useful as well. Thank you, the learning team, for giving us the opportunity to also present, and thank you, Anant.
Thank you so much, Piyush. Thank you. Thanks to all the members for being there on the webinar. Thanks a lot.
You guys.
Thank you.